Signore e signori, buonasera, benvenuti alla Casa Italiana, Zerilli-Marimò della New York University. We are delighted to have a chance to be the first institution and the first venue to present Maria Laurino's book, The Italian Americans, A History. Please welcome this book with a big applause. I assure you it deserves it even before you read it. The book was officially out yesterday. It already received an enthusiastic review today. We are delighted, as I said, that we are the first venue in which Maria is reading and talking about her book. As you know, this book is a companion to the documentary film that PBS is going to air in February, and we have the fortune to have here with us the director of the documentary, John Maggio, that is going to be with us in the discussion after that. I believe, and I'm not afraid to exaggerate, that the two things combined, this book and the documentary that John directed and that PBS is going to present, will radically change the way in which this country looks at Italian Americans. You will see them, you will read the book and you will see the documentary. I hope you'll do anything you can so that everybody watches the documentary when it comes out, not only the Italian Americans. We all, as Italian Americans, need to know our story, but it's the whole country that needs to know the story that is much more multifaceted, much more complicated, much more complex, much more diverse than we have been used to hear it. And what I think is the great merit of this book in particular is that everything written in it is accurate 100% from an historical point of view, and at the same time is beautifully written. It's a pleasure to read. It's not a book for scholars only, even if everything is scholarly proved. So I think that's what was really missing. There has been a great deal of scholarship on Italian-American issues in the last 10, 15 years. Many of these books we presented on this very stage, and we continue to do that. But very often I have the impression that these books really speak to people within a certain community of scholars that talk to each other, as it has to be on some level in the university community. And I think the great merit of this book is that it bridges the gap and it goes beyond the walls of academia. And it's a book that demands to be read by a larger public that wants to be informed and wants to be knowledgeable about a very, very important part of American society and of American history. And without further ado, we have another. What you saw is the trailer for the documentary. And we're going to see now a few minutes from the first episode of the documentary. And after that, Maria is going to talk about her book, to present it. And then we're going to have a roundtable that will include the director of the PBS documentary, Italian Americans, A History, John Maggio, and our own Tiro, Segno professor of Italian American Studies here at New York University, Professor Martino Marazzi. But now let's watch the clip from the first installment of the documentary.
Thank you all for coming tonight. My thanks to Stefano Albertini, who's been a friend for many years, and Stefano has just, his work here has been transformative, creating such a cultural and intellectual hub, and we thank you so much for what you've done, Stefano. And thank you also, Martino Marazzi, for joining us, and who has made great contributions to the literature of early Italian Americana. My friend John Maggio, who created such a superb documentary that I know you guys are going to love when it airs in February. And I just, you know, thank John for the gift of when he was doing the documentary, asked me if I could write the companion book. And I've always said, describing this project, I was nostalgic while I was writing it under deadline pressure, because I knew I would be nostalgic when it was done. That's how much fun it was. And also I want to thank, who's not on the panel, but who's here tonight, my editor at W.W. Norton, Elaine Salierno Mason. This is the third book on Italian-American culture that Elaine has been my editor, and I thank her for giving me this opportunity to publish my work. The two clips that you just saw this evening, the teaser to the series and the opening to the documentary, relay two important messages about the series and the book. The first is our attempt to strip away persistent, nagging stereotypes. The line, by the way, I'm going to make you an offer you can't refuse, Mario Puzo most likely borrowed it from the French novelist Honoré de Balzac, and another variation appears in the work of Western culture's first mythmaker in Homer's Odyssey, but the line has stuck to Italian Americans, becoming one of the most popular and parodied in American movie history. Our goal was to investigate and strip away these kinds of stereotypes, but also once we looked at these and they truly have haunted Italian Americans for decades, we didn't want to fall into another trap, which was to become overly nostalgic in portraying the immigrant experience. And I suggest in the book that one of the reasons that projects about the immigrant journey often get lost in nostalgia is because it possesses itself, this journey, an innately mythic quality. The American mythologist Joseph Campbell explained this so well when he famously patterned the mythic journey. Campbell argued that if you looked around the world, that all myths had the same pattern, and that is a hero with limited awareness has what he calls a call to adventure. He crosses the perilous ocean. He's always a he, by the way. There never seems to be a woman hero. He confronts dangers and enemies along the way. And if he survives this trial, he rededicates himself with renewed mastery. So in many ways, this mythic journey foreshadows the story of all immigrants coming to America. We ask ourselves, how did our grandfathers and great-grandfathers and great-great-grandfathers, all of our grandparents, summon up the exceptional courage to cross the monumental ocean, which is that particularly American call to adventure, and settle in the New World? How did they muster the bravery to face the isolation and brute labor and insults by others who saw themselves as more American? They were heroes, surely, but often a heroism born out of desperation. And we need to remember that these Southern Italian immigrants carried with them the scars of the past, centuries of poverty and subjugation. So the tension, then, in trying to honestly recount and reconstruct history is to balance both concepts, the heroic journey to modernity and the damage left by a futile and impoverished past. So that's what I tried to do when I was writing the book. The second clip about Rosetto, Pennsylvania, provided a story that framed both the documentary and the book, and John does return to it at the end of the series to find out what happened to people in Rosetto. But the idea was to think of Rosetto as a kind of metaphor for what Italian-American culture once represented, why many elements of it have disappeared, and if we can or want to claim parts of that life once again as an antidote to our kind of modern mechanized society. When the doctors conducted that health study that we just learned about, the Rosetto community was 95% Italian-American. So it was incredibly homogenous, probably the most homogenous ethnic enclave in the country. These immigrants had come from a town called Rosetto Valfattore in southern Italy, and they renamed the Pennsylvania town after their old home. It's a very appealing community to look at in thinking of many positive traits of the Italian American life. As we just saw, it's a supportive environment where people didn't feel alone. And among the reasons that the community was able to stave off heart disease was that the Rosettans chose to live a family and a community-centered egalitarian life. When I first researched Rosetto, I became very fascinated by this idea of their egalitarian life. For example, the very wealthy people they didn't have fancy homes, they didn't have fancy cars, they lived modestly, and they helped other residents. And I got a little carried away with this, and I began to romanticize Rosetto, thinking, well, maybe there's something special about Italian-American culture, that we are so much more egalitarian, and we were corrupted by American materialism. But then I realized that I, too, was becoming a romantic, and it was a reminder to never get too nostalgic when thinking about culture. What I did discover was that our ancestors brought with them aspects of Southern Italian culture that was both mystical and medieval. One of the reasons why the Rosettans didn't want to economically compete with each other is because they were afraid of success. And they were afraid of success because they thought it would bring the evil eye upon them. And they held this belief in the 1960s. This was the radical 1960s in many parts of America. But the Rosettans were actually creating potions to ward off the evil eye with olive oil and water and some tools. And of course, they wore the cornetto around the neck. Because Southern Italians, from illiterate peasants to cultured Neapolitans, believed very deeply that other people, through the power of their stare, could bring grave harm to others through what we call malocchio, the evil eye. One Rosettan told an Italian anthropologist studying the town, "The people think you're rich and they envy you, so you catch the evil eye. Envy is powerful. We say if envy were fever, the whole world would be in bed." So it's important to remember how strongly this fear of the evil eye was felt among the early immigrants. And when I think about this, I'm always reminded of a story that my mother would tell about her mother. Where one day my grandmother was walking out of church and she saw a couple that looked just particularly handsome that day. And so she wanted to tell them that and share that with them on how well they looked. And the next week the man dropped dead of a heart attack. And everyone suggested that my grandmother possessed the evil eye. So clearly there were elements of life in this cohesive town in Rosetto and in all these other ethnic enclaves that we wouldn't want to imitate today. And that's part of the story. Americans are intrigued by traditional places like Rosetto, and Italian Americans feel nostalgic about places like Rosetto because we do sense that not all of modernity is healthy or pleasing to the senses. But we also know that we wouldn't want to replicate a life forged in part on old world superstitions or one that shunned geographic mobility. So one inclination would be to meld these elements of the old world and the new. But in order to do that, we really need to understand our history so we can fully see the past and the patterns it left upon us and not sort of pick and choose and be nostalgic about it. And that is so much of what this Italian Americans project is all about. Through the PBS documentary and companion book, we want to explore a history that is often overlooked in American history books, as most immigrant histories are. The current debate about immigration reflects the reality that most of America's newest residents face difficult, unwanted, and often traumatic lives. We have always been a country that welcomes immigrants warily at best. I want to read you a short passage from my book that describes not only the distrust, but the downright hatred of early immigrants by the American academic establishment. And the origins of this prejudice started after unification in 1861. Before unification, Northerners had practically no contact with the South. But now they were witnessing the chaos, banditry, and disarray of a supposedly unified country. An Italian sociologist named Alfredo Nicioforo published a study in 1900 on what was being called the Southern Question, and his ideas added to the growing assumption of racial inferiority. Nicioforo wrote, "One of the two Italies, the northern one, shows a civilization greatly diffused, more fresh, and more modern. The Italy of the South shows a moral and social structure reminiscent of primitive and even quasi-barbarian times, a civilization quite inferior." One of these two Italies widely embraced Nocifero's study as a scientific, anthropological work, while the other half fumed, rejecting the notion of an innate inferiority. Nocifero's work would reverberate in America too, echoed and endorsed by sociologists and early 20th century eugenicists. A case in point was Edward Ellsworth Ross, an American sociologist and professor at Stanford and Cornell, and department chair at the University of Wisconsin. Ross, a prominent advocate of eugenics, explained in his book, The Old World and the New, that, quote, "In race advancement, the North Italians differ from the rest of their fellow countrymen. As he put it, in the veins of those from Piedmont, Lombardy, and Venetia runs much northern blood, Celtic, Gothic, Lombard, and German, while Southerners possess Greek, Saracen, and African blood." Quote, "Rarely is there so wide an ethnic gulf between the geographic extremes of a nation as there is between Milan and Palermo," Nocifero continued. "The astonishing dearth of literacy and artistic production in the South ought to confound those optimists who identify an Italian with Venetian and Tuscan, anticipate the Italian infusion will one day make the American stock bloom with poets and painters." The figures of Nocifero show that the provinces that contribute most to our immigration, and he puts this in italics, have been utterly sterile as creators of beauty. I have yet to meet an observer who does not rate the North Italian among us as more intelligent, reliable, and progressive than the South Italian. We know from statistics he is less turbulent, less criminal, less transient. The sociologist's racial and genetic assumptions come into fuller view under a section titled Lack of Mental Ability. Ross wrote that, quote, steerage passengers from a Naples boat show a distressing frequency of low foreheads, open mouths, weak chins, poor features, skew faces, small or knobby crania, and backless heads. Such people lack the power to take rational care of themselves. His jaw-dropping description, drawing on the concept of phrenology popular at the time, leaves the modern reader to wonder both what is a backless head and what was the shape of the heads choosing university faculty in the early 1900s. It's astonishing, really, the prejudice described as a sociological study. And today I can only shudder at the thought of what my poor illiterate grandparents faced, and my parents, the children of illiterate peasants, trying to assimilate in the middle class section of a fancy New Jersey suburb. After completing the Italian Americans of history, I better understood this trajectory of shame spanning the 20th century. In the early part of the century, much of the Anglo-Saxon elite despised Southern Italians, believing they brought a criminality to the United States, either through the mafia or through anarchist radicals like Sacco and Vanzetti. For a brief time, America had a love affair with a dictator named Benito Mussolini, who in the 1920s they saw as the antidote to communism. But by the 1930s, the reality of fascism sunk in, and by the 40s, Italy was our enemy. Again, Italian Americans became suspect, their loyalties questioned. By the 50s, 60s, and 70s, Italian Americans were working hard to assimilate into American life, trying to offset this prejudice. But by then, we had another prejudice to deal with. The Kefauver and Valachi congressional committees on organized crime placed national attention on the Italian mafia. By the time Mario Puzo published The Godfather in 1969, far too many Americans were making guilt by association judgments about Italian Americans. And when Francis Ford Coppola's movie version of The Godfather came out in 1972, the entire country became fascinated with this idea of the Italian family and the mob. The positive associations of family that places like Roseto, Pennsylvania had once showed us were being replaced with this sinister one. It took until the 1980s for the New York Times to feature a cover story on their magazine of Italian Americans finally coming into their own, featuring Mario Cuomo, Geraldine Ferraro, Chrysler president Lee Iacocca, Yale president Bart Giametti. But by the 80s, something else amazing began to happen, and that is Italian became chic, food, fashion, design. Everyone seemed to want something that was Italian. But still, I would argue that the same distinctions were taking place between what was considered the beautiful part of Italy, the North, compared to the poor peasant South, where the majority of Italian Americans claimed their roots. It would take many more years for Italian Americans to come into their own. I'd like to conclude before joining my panel of three Italian men, what could be better, by reading from the last chapter of my book. Now, usually an author wouldn't give away an ending, but I don't think I'm revealing any great surprises here. There's actually another reason why I want to read part of this ending tonight, and that's because my friend Stefano Albertini helped inspire the idea for it, which was to write about an unlikely hero of the international art world, a retired Italian-American auto mechanic. Today, it's hard to imagine that the 20th century began with austere and venerated Americans pronouncing Southern Italians as nothing but trouble. Or considering the wide-ranging artistic achievement of Italian Americans, to look back to those darker days when a sociologist prophesied with italicized emphasis that the South of Italy was and would always be utterly sterile as creators of beauty. Creators of beauty define the way America sees the many Italian Americans of Southern descent who became its most beloved actors, filmmakers, singers, composers, writers, architects, chefs, and designers. In the visual arts, Massimiliano Gioni became, in 2013, the youngest artistic director in the 118-year history of the Venice Biennale, the most prestigious art exhibition in the world. Joni grew up outside of Milan and lives in New York with his Milanese wife, who is also a curator. They represent the latest wave first-generation Italians, well-educated men and women who seek America's vibrant multiculturalism. For the Biennale, Joni, then 39, chose to showcase the encyclopedic palace of the world, the work of an Italian-American auto mechanic and self-taught Pennsylvania artist named Marino Oriti. By making Oriti's work the theme of the exhibition, Joni embraced the idea of this outsider artist in order to charge the imagination of the world's leading artists. In the 1950s, Orridi built in his backyard the Encyclopedic Palace of the World, an 11-foot architectural model made of wood, brass, plastic, and celluloid to showcase his dream, a 136-story skyscraper museum that would contain all the world's knowledge. Orridi imagined that the building and its surrounding piazza would encompass 16 blocks in Washington, D.C. His eccentric vision, long before the internet, of amassing and showcasing the world's knowledge would have remained in storage if his family hadn't taken up its cause. His granddaughter, B.G. Fermani, explored the American Folk Art Museum, but initially thought its objects of pure Americana, weather vanes, quilts, and Shaker wood, portended an unlikely fit for her grandfather's Baroque vision. But hanging on a wall was Iceman Crucified No. 3 by Ralph Fasanella, the self-taught Italian-American painter whose bright colors and thick brushstrokes depicted the ethnic group's struggles and icons. The painting portrayed Fasanella's father, who was an Iceman, crucified on a giant block of ice. "I felt such a mixture of grief and hope," wrote Fermani, "that I burst into tears, and then I thought, this is the place." The American Folk Art Museum displayed Orridi's Encyclopedic Palace of the World in 2004. In 2012, it became the centerpiece of a new exhibition, and soon after led the Biennale. In Venice, the Encyclopedic Palace, standing in the opening gallery of the cavernous exhibition space, welcomed nearly 500,000 people who visited the six-month-long art fair. The model with four entrance points greeted visitors in English, Italian, French, and Spanish. Orridi printed above its Doric columns aphorisms for how to live ethically. "Watch that you don't become greedy with your profits. The less you desire, the greater your happiness. Surround yourself with honest friends and live long and happily. Live by your work." These sentiments, deeply Italian in spirit, mirror the egalitarian credo that guided the settlers of Rosetto, Pennsylvania in the late 19th century and the many others who followed. Orridi, born in 1891, a decade after the first eight men from Rosetto Valfattori made the New World their home, set forth on an immigrant journey that echoed the struggles of millions of Italian Americans caught in the tumult of history. After Orridi published satirical anti-fascist poems in a local paper in the 1920s, fascist goons force-fed him castor oil and took over his home. His wife was born in America, but her family, among the early birds of passage who had returned to Italy, could not re-enter the country because of the restrictive 1924 Johnson-Reed Act, nor could Orridi secure illegal immigration. By going first to Brazil, Orridi and his wife eventually found their way to America. By the time Orridi designed his Encyclopedic Palace, he had retired as an auto mechanic. Yet he still possessed a dream particular to the immigrant experience. He was audacious and bold enough to imagine synthesizing and sharing the world's knowledge. The amateur craftsman would never live to see streams of international artists paying homage to his vision. But years after his death, Orridi's daughter had a dream in which her father stood one more time in the backyard, the place where he loved to tinker with oversized ideas. He was holding a tiny living tree with its root ball intact and offering the words that every child who has lost a beloved parent wants to hear. Io vivo, I live. The roots planted by immigrants in a once inhospitable New World soil are not only intact but thriving. Each subsequent generation, preserving and passing along pieces of Italian-American culture that fed and sustained them, continues to strengthen the stem and nourish the branches. Noi viviamo, we live.
Front row, we freed them up so you, instead of standing, you can sit up here. Thank you. Maria, thank you also for the beautiful presentation. And this gives me an inspiration for my first question that is both for you and for John. You decided to read this beautiful conclusion of your book that is not included in the documentary. But the book, as we said, is a companion to the documentary in the sense that the structure of the book, the chapters that we have, are similar to the structure of the documentary, with a few changes. How did you work it out? Was it something that you sat down and decided to do together? There was already some sort of structure that was agreed upon. How did it work, the collaboration between the writer of the book and the director of the documentary?
Well, in the chicken and egg question of what came first, the book or the documentary came first. So maybe, John, you want to talk about that?
You know, it's interesting because there are, in trying to tell a history, it's different than writing a history book when you're making a visual, work in a visual medium. And there are certain stories that lend themselves to both, they lend themselves to, you know, trying to recreate scenes, and, you know, Rosetta was a perfect example of that. It lives in a different way in a film than it does in a book. So I chose stories that speak a little bit more, that I knew I could tell in kind of a more broad way, avoiding archetypes, but in, you know, it's a kind of a cruel medium that I work in. You can't go as deep often. You have to keep an audience engaged. The visual aspect of it is part of it. So I went about crafting the film, not really thinking about the companion book, but just how am I going to tell the history, the breadth of the history, and what scenes are going to help tell that story. So when I met and read Maria's, I read her book first, and then I met her when we went, came and interviewed her, I realized that what she brought to her writing was a kind of a light touch. It had all the depth I loved about the history and the scholarship, but it had a light touch, it had a very personal touch, and I thought that was the right complement to the material that I was trying to shape. And sure enough, she took what I had done in the film and brought it to a much deeper level. I mean, you heard her, just, I love listening to you read, because I think, is that what I'm saying in the film? Like, I'm always amazed at how much deeper you brought things. So I felt very honored and lucky that the stories that I chose, for a large part, are in the book. And then she went even further, especially at the end, to take it to a different place than the place that I end.
Well, yeah, I mean, it was such a pleasure to do this with John. It was just a great, great collaborative project. But yes, John had said to me from the start, you know, it's 4 hours, and 4 hours is a good chunk of time, but that's not what a book can do. You can go much deeper, and that's what he wanted me to do. So it was a great sort of assignment in that way to take. I always say that the documentary is the kind of scaffolding, that every part of the documentary, there's a chapter in the book. I ended up adding a couple other chapters, a chapter on the Italian-American counterculture, because we thought that was interesting to talk about, too, and just recognizing that he only had a limited amount of time. And then from that, yeah, there was just certain directions that it seemed, you know, the material could lend itself, and I was able to do that in the book.
Maria, in the book you have a sort of a recurrent rubric that is our ancestors. Of these people, was any of them a discovery, somebody that you did not know at all or you knew very little? And which one of these people you talk about in the book is the one that impressed you the most or left the most durable trace in you?
That's a good question. I think it's a... No, I didn't know all of them. And I think it's a tough call between a couple. One was someone John wanted to include in the documentary, Angelo Lombace, but because of time, he wasn't able to. And they had interviewed her grandchildren, right? And so John gave me access to all of his material and transcripts, so I had this wealth of information. And from that, I thought she was a very interesting labor leader and someone definitely worthy of writing this Our Ancestors about. And then the other Our Ancestor who I really loved was Florence Scala, who was an activist in Chicago. And I kind of stumbled upon her when I was looking through the material of the Kefauver and Valachi congressional committees and what was going on with organized crime at the time, on how this became the obsession of you know, the American public, sort of linking this to Italian Americans. And a friend of mine had written a biography of the mayor of Chicago, and he had mentioned to me Florence Scala, and I realized that her activism was taking place at the same time as the Valachi hearings. But no one really heard of this Italian-American woman trying to save Little Italy in Chicago when Mayor Daley was basically had the bulldozers there to build a branch of the University of Chicago there. University of Illinois in Chicago, mm-hmm. I'm sorry, not the University of Chicago. So she became a really interesting figure.
And I don't want to steal the whole thing because the deal was that Maria would be drilled by the three of us, so I'm going to leave the microphone for their questions. And John, obviously you're Italian-American, and But you are a professional documentary maker. You have done many others. You're working right now on another fascinating project that didn't have anything to do with, that doesn't have anything to do with Italian Americans. How was your personal experience in going to your own roots and exploring who you are and where you come from compared to the other projects, many projects you have worked on so far?
That's a good question. I had never conceived of, nor do I often think about when I want to make a film or I'm thinking about making a film, something as broad as an entire people. You know, I had never really thought of that. I tend to make films about smaller characters that try to tell a larger truth about a situation, about America, about whatever I happen to be covering. So this was a real challenge to me because I thought it seems so daunting. You know, everyone has their own experience. It was a challenge, a different challenge for me in making the films I normally make. The irony of my situation is that I run a series and have run a series for a number of years called Finding Your Roots with Henry Louis Gates Jr. That's on PBS. And there's been many incarnations of that African-American lives. And part of that warrant is to dig into our histories and our past through genealogy and tell history through a family history. And I've always been encouraged by the people I work with to look into my own history, and I just never had. I literally just had never thought to do it because I've been so busy. And so when this project came up and somebody approached me, they asked me if I'd ever made a film, interested in making this film, it made me really think about my own family history. And you know, our family lore was that, not lore, but lore, is that we were from Sicily, but yet there was no documentation of that. My grandparents were dead. There was nothing ever written. It was kind of passed down. And so I thought, well, if I don't really know anything on both sides of my family, I bet you a lot of Italians don't. And that's exactly what I found. I went out and I met a lot of people who just have always assumed they're from somewhere over there, but never actually really looked. And so that intrigued me, this idea of where does that come from? Why don't we remember? Why don't we tell history that way? And that brought up another challenge, which was there was not a huge tradition amongst these Italian peasants, many of them illiterate, that came here, of writing anything down. So everything was passed down orally, unlike the Jews or the Irish, who had more of that sort of tradition. So there was a whole host of challenges in making this film, not only just creatively and aesthetically for me, but also just on a personal level in delving my own history, which I still need to do, by the way.
One more thing. Whenever I told anybody that I had the fortune to see a rough cut of the documentary last spring in one afternoon marathon at the Calandra Institute, and I was so struck that I spoke about it to anybody, and the first question people were asking said, is there a lot of mafia in it? And of course, it's a legitimate question. That's one of the concern of Italian Americans, that their history has always been associated with organized crime. And I think you both deal in the book and in the film with the issue in a very balanced way. Of course, you do not shy away from telling these stories, and at the same time, you seem to attribute a small part, in the much larger and much more complicated and complex picture of Italian Americans. Was this a particularly delicate topic for both of you to work on, and how you dealt with it vis-a-vis the rest of the fresco that you both painted in words and in images?
Yeah, well, it was interesting for me because I had never written about the mafia before. I never had any interest writing about the mafia, and my other two books about Italian American culture were very personal. So this was, it was interesting to do the personal first and then do a historical book. And so I learned a lot along the way. Again, just so, it's so important to understand the course of history and the patterns, and then you can understand so much about yourself as a culture. And you know, Italian Americans need to deal with the fact that you know, they have this very impoverished past, and some people did join gangs, which were the Black Hand, terrorizing other Italian Americans, terrorizing other Italian Americans in the turn of the century. And then the government really helped in a way, or start bootlegging with Prohibition. Because when Prohibition became law, it just opened up this whole means of illegal distribution of alcohol. And a lot of these Black Hand members came back and actually became full-fledged mobsters and very rich and very legitimate. So it was interesting to kind of watch that progression in history. And then even to look at a figure like Mario Puzo, who I think was, I saw so much in reading The Godfather of his kind of Southern Italian cynicism. You know, this notion that there was somehow this, you could equate a government that was corrupt with corrupt cops and with this sort of parallel society. And so if you were going to find corruption in government, why couldn't someone else sort of take over too and create their own, you know, their own organization? And what's so dangerous about that, and what's so dangerous about that cynicism, and I think about this all the time, and looking at Southern Italy today and reading a book like, you know, Roberto Savini's brilliant book Gomorra on how the mafia or the Camorra in Naples has controlled so much of that economy. That in America, you know, we had acts like RICO, where the government came in and really helped stop so much of this organized crime. And you had the American civic structure, you know, imposing a sense of order. And it made me realize how dangerous that kind of cynicism is, that it's all equated, you know, that it's all, if you have corrupt cops, then you can have, you know, organized crime too, and how dangerous that is, because Puzo really, really romanticized the mafia in creating this figure of Don Corleone, who seemed so admirable in so many ways.
Based on his mother?
He said that, yes. But, you know, the interesting thing is that in the 50s and 60s, you had these two major congressional committees, Kefauver and then Valachi. He was the gangster Valachi, but he was describing the structure of organized crime to the congressional committee. And Puzo just got those transcripts. I read this interview with Puzo where he said, you know, for $10, I got like hundreds and hundreds of pages, well, actually thousands of pages. And he took these transcripts and he said he never met a gangster, you know, except a few of the guys who knew who ran numbers in Hell's Kitchen. So, you know, he just took these transcripts and made this kind of tawdry novel out of it, and the rest is kind of history.
My challenge was in raising money for the project in the community, because I would have these elaborate lunches with people from, you know, wealthy businessmen, Italian Americans, who were interested in the arts, interested in supporting what I was doing. But no matter what, on several, like, I'd get to Act Three, and I'd be like, "Oh, and so it's the deal with the mob," and I couldn't even get the word out of my mouth, and a fight would ensue. The typical sort of wonderful Southern Italian familial way, we would get in these huge arguments, you know, and I'd walk out, and I wouldn't get any money. So that was the sticking point. But my argument was always, you know, there is nothing that has defined us more, unfortunately, than that stigma. And for me, it's not even the mafia, it's the Godfather. It became the de facto history, for me even, of my own people. I mean, I grew up, I didn't learn this history in grammar school or high school, you know, my immigrant history. I was taught the Pilgrims and, you know, the typical sort of thing. And I had no connection to it, but the Godfather I connected to. A lot of people did. A lot of people for the first time saw their families on the screen. And you know, Godfather 2, the history of Don Vito coming over, it was all like, it just seemed to like come to life. And that was really unfortunate. It really became the de facto history for Americans. So that's what I wanted to dismantle. I wasn't necessarily, it's such a small fraction of our community that is involved with this thing. So I wanted to trace it back and really kind of understand it. And it's true what Maria was saying, when you stumble upon Puzo, he's the myth maker, he's the bard, he's the guy who took this story and made it writ large based on this tiny group of people, and had such a huge effect on our community. So,
thank you. I would like to briefly introduce Martino Marazzi now. As I told you, he's the Tiro Segno Professor of Italian American Studies here at New York University. Let me open a little parenthesis about the Tiro Segno Professorship, because we have here Vito Vincenti, who at that time was the president of the Tiro Segno Foundation. The Tiro Segno is the oldest Italian American club in the United States, and as far as I'm aware, is the only one who did such a fundamental thing to give back to Italian Americans their culture, a sense of who they are and what they really represent. And when with Vito we were deciding what would be the right thing to do, short of doing a documentary on PBS, was to create a chair in Italian American Studies that would give a chance to the future leading classes of this country coming through NYU to have an approach to Italian-American history that would be as deep and complex as possible. And thanks to the Tiro Segno Visiting Professorship, we are able every other year to invite a scholar to NYU that teaches two courses, one at the graduate level and one at the undergraduate level, on different aspects. We had film historians, sociologists, historians, literary critics, food historians, you name it. So all the different aspects, political scientists, all the different aspects of the Italian-American experience are being explored at New York University thanks to this professorship that is currently held by Professor Marazzi. Interesting that, again, it's a scholar of Italian-American literature, in the case of Professor Marazzi, who is a professor at the University of Milan. And it's the proof of a renewed interest in Italy for Italian-American studies, a discipline that up until a few years ago was completely unknown and is now represented by brilliant scholars that are doing groundbreaking works like the work that Martino is doing. And that's why I took advantage of his presence here at NYU to be with us on the round table.
Well, my main problem being Tiro Segno professor, as you said, that it's a visiting position. So I'm not going to be able to be here in February to see the documentary. So you'll have to invite either you prolong the visiting professorship, so I'll be here in February. I've been able to read the book, which is good.
Or convince Rai to buy it and broadcast it in Italy. Oh, very good.
Apart from the joke, but it does also make me think, because I think that this book in particular and the documentary, or even just from the little that I've seen, are going to be really of tremendous importance here for the Italian American community, for the American readership and public more in general. But it would also be very, very important that both these products, the book and the documentary, would make it to Italy and be shown in Italy and translated into Italian. To reach a wider audience, because I think the history of Italians worldwide, not only in North America, in the US and in Canada, but also in South America, in Australia, all around Europe, is really the history of another Italy. And what Maria Laurino has made very well, and I'm sure the documentary has done similarly, is also to show the subtlety and the complexity of this history, which is not easy. It's not easy because, for instance, in the book, there's the story of Italian-American fascism, but there's also the story of Sacco and Vanzetti. You have, on the one hand, a generoso Pope. On the other hand, you have Fiorello La Guardia. You have in the 60s the Mario Savio, and one of my favorite parts of the book is this great portrait of the beat poet Gregory Corso. So it is a very complex and a nuanced history, and there is the Roseto effect, however we want to frame it. And I would say now in Italy we have a similar effect, which I would call it the Rosarno effect, which is the exact opposite. I mean, Italy now has witnessed almost the same amount of immigrants as we speak as Italians who came to this country. That is around 4.5 million, but they're rising more and more every day as we speak, with almost 10% dying every day in the Mediterranean. And this is a huge tragedy and problem, and it's going to be a structural change of Italy and of all of Europe. And the way Italian institutions, not only the racist parts of Italy, are dealing with this is not very healthy and is not very open-minded. Rosarno is the name of this village, which is not very far away from Roseto in the Puglia, where the people first hired and exploited as slave labor black Africans and Eastern European to pick up oranges in the winter. And then when they were tired of them, started shooting at them. So, and that's nothing to do with the Northern League, it's nothing to do with the government, you know, common people going out on the fields and shooting at these people, at these other immigrants. So Italians should really better look into themselves, at themselves, and look at their history, and trying to be more Roseto than Rosarno. So that's something.
Questions?
I mean, I would have tons. I was struck how Maria presented two of her favorite figures, because actually they were the very same ones that I wrote down in my little summary, and I had added another one in a typical Trinitarian Italian fashion, which is one of my favorite poets of the early days, Arturo Giovannitti, who also you mentioned, and also that also brings me to another sort of bridge between the book and the documentary, which is the really great work that you and your publisher have done in terms of the iconography, because, for instance, in order to make this really forgotten and unknown poet more visible, you reproduce some of his handwritten poems, which you took from the personal family, from the personal archives. Florence Scala, also, I had no idea who she was, but being an old fan of all the books by Studs Terkel, then I read that she, Studs Terkel, thought that she was the epitome of the Chicagoans, so that made me even more, made her dearer to me. And also the way you deal with such a thorny issue like fascism is very, very subtle. And you know, the great late Italian writer Ennio Flaiano, the screenwriter of the Dolce Vita, used to say in one of his very provocative aphorisms that in Italy, fascists divide themselves into two categories, fascists and anti-fascists. And one wonders what he could have said about the Italian Americans of the 20s and 30s. I think we would have been quite close. But you do a great job also of describing how, for instance, FDR and LaGuardia passed Columbus Day around the same time. So, I mean, I've nothing but praise about this book, really.
Well, Martino, what do you think the Italians would find particularly interesting and unknown that you found in this book? So let's say there is an Italian audience reading it. Which of these stories would sound more?
Well, apart from the stories, I think they would get a sense of a society, not a disparate group of people who are, you know, flocking over here and living whatever life they would find through hardship, but a real, like, an entire people with its own contradiction, but also with its dignity and with its culture. Devotion to the Our Lady of Mount Carmel, with its politics, with its desire to have fun. That's another big you know, a theme. All the Rat Pack group, the Sinatra and Italian-American cinema. And very early on, Italian-Americans organized themselves in the colonies in order to go, in the weekend, to go out to the theater and listen to the Farfariellos or the Neapolitan songs. And so it was a very structured, coherent, cohesive society from the east to the west coast. And that's something that really, I wouldn't say is overlooked, it's totally ignored by Italians. Italians don't have a sense that there's another Italy. And that's also why, and to a certain extent, sometimes I also think that Italian Americans or Italian Argentinians don't have a clear sense of the Italy that they've left behind. So the two things need to get closer to make, you know.
But Martino, you teach Italian American literature at the University of Milan. Are your students interested? Do you see a growing interest in it?
I teach it here. It's not as if I'm not allowed to teach it over in Italy, but you know, I'm required to teach like standard, you know, Dante and Boccaccio. And
are you able every now and then to insert one of your Italian American authors?
Yeah. I do insert it.
Some Giovannitti. In between a Dante and a Tasso.
Yeah, and La Guardia,
Good to know.
Absolutely. Now, and I do find interest. But one of the problems, if you want to go, you know, if you want to do the real thing, is that oftentimes the sources are not available, even here, and even worse in Italy. So it's quite difficult. You know, I do find passionate young students who come to me and want to work on this material, and also sort of a same reaction that I found here, where almost half of my class has nothing to do with Italian-American heritage, and they just want to hear the Italian-American story as one of the variable of a greater immigrant history of America. And the other half of the class, yes, they would be much more knowledgeable about things Italian, and they want to get to know more themselves. But I do find a similar reaction also back in Italy. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, one of the things that fascinates me, just to pick up on Martino's comments, is that I know that when I travel to Italy, and you know, we've become friends with Italians there, and I talk about this kind of passion that I have for being Italian, that Italians don't consider Italian Americans Italian.
Right.
And it's just so frustrating to us, you know. And I say to them, you know, I am genetically completely Southern Italian. this must have something to do with how I feel and how I think about things. And it's like, no, you don't speak the language, you're not Italian. And it is a very, you know, frustrating disconnect.
Right. It's true, but I think you're both right to a certain extent. And that's why it's hard to make such a scholarly work, so to speak, because you really have to convince both sides that we're all part of the same history. But it's a history that after the Italian unification and during the Great Migration really diverged more and more. And
the issue of the language, as Maria is pointing out, is that you don't speak the language and you're not Italian. We have to keep in mind that for almost 1,000 years, the only thing that defined who an Italian was the fact that they had some understanding of the standard literary Italian, what we now call Italian. It was then called the vernacular, because there was no political unity. Therefore, between somebody living in Milan and somebody living in Palermo, they shared not the everyday language that remained the dialect of Milan and the dialect of Palermo, but the literary language that we now call Italian. So it was that very sort of abstract and fluctuant unifying factor that is the Italian language that somehow defined who an Italian was. And now it would be, you know, one of the new challenges, as Martino was mentioning, regarding contemporary immigration to Italy. And is Fred Corno here? Yes, Fred is back there. He's studying exactly the thing. He's a documentary maker from Italy, and he's working on Italians, first generation Italian, kids that were actually born in Italy, are perfectly fluent in Italian, went through all the schools in Italy, and they are not Italian citizens, and they don't have their rights recognized as Italian citizens, even if they speak the language. So it stops short of recognizing a new Italian. But it's enough to exclude somebody who is genetically Italian.
Right.
So, but the issue of the language is very interesting and very contradictory.
Yeah, if I can add just a footnote, I think Italians should also realize to a certain extent that you can be Italian and speak English, or you can be Italian and speak Spanish, or you can be Italian and speak French. There were like hundreds of thousands of Italian immigrants in the banlieue of Paris. So that's when you read a novel like Christ in Concrete, there's no doubt that that is an Italian novel, even though from page 1 to page 300, it's all written in English. But it's another way of defining Italian, you know. And so we have to open up and reach that adjective. It's not only what happens in between the Alps and Sicily, but it's also what happened in other parts of the world. And yes, after a generation, you do speak another language. That also opens up a whole other chapter, which is very fascinating. But bottom line, you can be Italian or and speak another language. I came to this conclusion.
Excellent. Before we keep asking questions to each other, maybe we want also to see if there are any questions from the audience, understanding that the book just came out today. We have copies upstairs for you to buy, and Maria is going to be happy to sign them for you. And of course, the documentary is going to be aired in February. By the way, we are working on a very, very special preview of a part of the documentary, a selection, sometimes between the end of January and the beginning of February. We have 2-3 dates we're looking at. It's a complicated organizational thing. It's going to happen. It's going to happen here at New York University, not here at Casa Italiana. We need a larger venue. That's why the thing is made more complicated. But we're working on it. And as soon as we have a date, we will let you know, so you'll have a chance to see your special preview of the PBS documentary before it airs in its entirety, February 7th, 17th and 7th and 24th. 17th and 24th, 2 hours and 2 hours. Okay, and questions, Laura Caparrotti.
Yes, all the language is, after living here for 10 years, I do speak another language. I don't know if I'm Italian, considering Italian anymore, because I speak Italian English. I'm interested in the shame part, because I remember I created an exhibition in Montclair years ago about the immigration of Italians in Montclair. And there was a lot of, we had a lot of
can't
complaints.
Hear her back here.
I created an exhibition in Montclair years ago where there were some. It was difficult to display it because they, like the people who brought all it was based on oral history. So everyone who brought something. When we made the exhibition, like.
What was the exhibition?
About the immigration of Italians in Montclair. So it was, there was a lot of shame going on, and it was difficult to show their history because they didn't want, I mean, they wanted to show their history in a way, but not in, like, as an historical part of the history of America. It was just more, this is our memory, and it's between us. It doesn't have to be shown everywhere. So I'm interested in both of you, how much the shame is still there. I feel like the young generation doesn't feel it, but I'm really interested in this aspect.
Thank you.
Well, in both the documentary and the book, there's a section and a chapter called Becoming American, which talks about the early immigrants and then the second generation, the kind of shame, especially the second generation. We talk about the wonderful educator, Leonard Covello, whose name had been Leonardo Coviello. And when he went to school, his teacher, who he names Mrs. Cutter eponymously, tells him to cut the syllables from his name. And he comes back with his report card, and he's Leonard Covello. And his father says, what happened to the I in Covello? What happened to Coviello? Well, my teacher couldn't pronounce it, so we had to change it. And it was those kinds of stories, the incredible pain of the parents saying, how can you change a family name, to the second generation son actually kind of happy that his name was made a little easier. It seems to be that if you could say, you know, without generalizing, if there's a pattern to the immigrant experience, the first generation is just dedicated to finding a place, and it's so much hard work and there's so much pain. The second generation begins to feel that pull and tug of loyalty to the family, but also loyalty to this new country. And then it really isn't until the third or fourth generation that you get to have a little distance and you get to play a little more with culture and realize, you know, the parts of it that you really want to hold on to. But you need to be here for for several generations in order to have kind of be relaxed enough to do that. And well, what I always say about culture is that, you know, when you're young, everybody just wants to fit in. That's, you know, you just want to be like everybody else. And when you're older, you want to know what's different about you. You don't want to be like everybody else. And culture and identity is a very important way to distinguish yourself. And that's why I think you begin to see this fascination today, third, fourth, fifth generation hyphenated Americans with wanting to reclaim part of the culture.
That was in going out, and most of the storytelling I wanted to do was through families. I didn't want to, there's not a lot of scholars in the film. It's mostly family stories. And what I encountered was that, and what I learned along the way with this term bella figura, which is about always presenting a kind of positive image. And I think Italians are very good at controlling message, especially when you're impoverished, you know. So a lot of these old timers, they just wanted to, that's why what we talk about is this nostalgia. You can cover everything in nostalgia because you're hiding the pain. And so for me, I'd be in these very long interviews of people just chipping away at this, you know, a lot of yeah, but what was that like? And then when I put it all together, I started realizing, wow, this was hard. I mean, people, they were, you know, these early immigrants were like cannon fodder for the industrial age here in America. I mean, limbs and death. But it's true, you know, every turn when I got beyond that facade of shame, that's what they are ashamed of. And to Maria's point, I guess I'm third generation, but I felt it going to I went to Catholic schools my whole life. And my grammar school was all Italian. They called us St. Guido. It was St. Margaret's. They called it St. Guido's, which I actually learned after I left St. Guido's that it was called St. Guido's by the Irish high school that I went to, all Irish. And I got so, I mean, these are some of my close friends, but, you know, it's the first time I heard Dago and WAP and all this stuff. And that's in the 80s, you know. And then I'm a third generation person. And I remember thinking, wanting to change my name to Jonathan. I thought that would somehow make me sound more WASPy or fit in. But it's all of this, to your point, you just want to fit in. And there is a certain amount of shame that always goes along with it. And I think it's been carried on longer for Italian Americans because of, we were delayed in assimilation, I think. We got stuck in these enclaves, and we talk about that in the film, longer than other groups.
Thank you. Other questions?
If I may, two questions.
If they're brief, yes.
So I saw the preview of the documentary in Pelham. I was there. I don't know if you remember. So I was particularly struck by the when you talk about Cuomo, and then the first question is about why we have already had so many Italian American politicians. Also in the last elections, there were so many Italian American candidates. New York has had a lot of Italian American mayors, but why there's never been an Italian American president? And the second question is, you're dealing a lot with stereotypes that somehow sounds from the past, like mafia, the Godfather, but what about the new stereotypes? Or like the Jersey Shore things, the Guidos and Guidette. So Italian Americans are not only linked to mafia, but very often to like sort of tacky culture. That's it.
Hello? Oh, sorry. On that first question, if I could answer that, I would be a very rich man. I think that it still has everything to do with media portrayals of Italians. I mean, that was a sort of, for a while, that was an animating question for me in the final hour. You know, why haven't we had, will there ever be an Italian-American president in our lifetime? And I think it's, I honestly don't know. I mean, we discuss this every once in a while, and it's sort of like, is it because of the old prejudices? I mean, we've got Chris Christie is Italian. He's from New Jersey. They're coming from from the East Coast, which is, there's always a natural prejudice against East Coast politicians getting into national office. There's so many things, it's freighted so much. I mean, JFK was a Catholic. That was a huge thing to surmount. So I'm not sure, you know, and I'm not sure what we learn from the Obama experience, you know. I don't know that there's a direct correlation to having made it because you're president anymore. And in the film, we talk about, and it's a very interesting thing, and I think it's almost sort of press-worthy, Antonin Scalia, who's in the film, he posits that Italian-Americans might be more proud to have a justice, because in his estimation, a Supreme Court justice, because in his estimation, a justice is almost uncorruptible, whereas politicians, hold your laughter. I did preface that it was his estimation. But it's an interesting thing, the way he thinks about it in those terms, that it's this sort of idea of the corruptibility of Italian-American character, that politics is a sort of fertile ground for, and so therefore there'll never be an Italian. It's completely facile, but this is something I think that is just pervasive in America.
You're being recorded, John.
And what was the second question? Oh, yeah. All right. I have a quick, interesting story about that, because there is. First of all, I think fortunately or unfortunately, Italian American families are a little often outsized. When you get a group of us together, we'll talk. We use our hands, as you can see. We get very. It lends itself to the television, and I think there's a lot of interest in that. There's even on these sort of non-mafia type shows like Mob Wives, and there's so many. There's a new one now, the Dawn of Pittsburgh or something. Even just in the Jersey Housewives and all these, it's always these sort of outsized Italian characters, you know, where they're easy to cast, they're cheap to make, and people eat it up. And what's happening in Italy is in Naples, there's a filmmaker who started making a series about Neapolitan wedding singers, which is like a huge experience there. When you get married in Naples, you hire a wedding singer to come and serenade the bride, and it's like really over the top. And I saw a snippet of it, and I was like, oh my God, that's Staten Island. Like, I recognize these people. I get it. And the Italians hate it. I don't know if you've come across this. And now he's gone on to, there's a whole new series about baptisms or something, which is also way over the top in Naples. And there's in Northern Italians and Roman, they hate that they're expressing the culture in this way. But it's even made it over there. So
let's say it's very foreign to us.
Exactly. Well, no, but I mean, it exists. And when you see those faces, absolutely, you know, it's like the opening scene of our film in Rosetto. It's like, I know those faces. And that's happening there. And so to your point about what are the differences? Can you be Italian and Italian-American? I mean, we're cut from the same cloth, if you look close enough.
Maria, maybe you have your own insight, because before your career as a writer, you had a long career in politics as a speechwriter and in many other capacities with different prominent personalities. Why none of them ever even made it close to the presidency?
Well, I don't know. But no, it is an interesting question. You know, in the film, there's a line that Mario Cuomo says. It's a very touching line about, you know, here I came, I grew up in the deli that his father had in Queens, and I became, you know, was elected to the highest office in the state of New York. Isn't that enough for one generation? And I was very struck by that quote. And there's always been these rumors about this guilt by association of Mario Cuomo and the mob, and, you know, was there something on the side of his in-laws and all of that. And I don't know, I actually feel, well, I guess what I've learned in politics was that if you ever think conspiracy, it's usually a mistake. And, you know, when people sort of put tales together, I think that there was also something about Mario Cuomo, that there was a Southern Italian fatalism. You know, that he did feel that he achieved what he achieved, and that it is hard. There's only so far you could go in a certain generation about getting beyond that fatalism. And I guess I'm more optimistic about, I feel if we could elect Barack Obama, we can elect an Italian-American president. And what I always think about is when, you know, Rudolph Giuliani had a terrible campaign for president, but here it was Wayne Barrett, an investigative reporter, wrote a book on Rudy Giuliani that showed that his father was tied to the mafia. That first his father was arrested, he had a criminal history, and then that he worked in a bar where he collected loans for people and basically beat them up if they didn't pay. That didn't stop Rudy Giuliani from running for president. And there was never, his campaign failure was because of Rudy Giuliani. It wasn't because people were saying, oh, well, his father was a mob, you know, was tied to the mob. They saw him as a prosecutor and a mayor who was very anti-mafia. So I do think that if the right candidate comes comes up, and that it certainly is possible. And for the second question, I think, you know, it's just cheap and it's easy to get these really over-the-top characteristic, and what's really difficult is seeing how ethnicity becomes more nuanced in the generations and with each generation. Yes, there certainly are aspects of what it means to be Italian-American, but it's not the train wreck you see on TV. But that's really seems to be more left for a novelist than a TV maker doing a, you know, a reality television show. And that's what we're left with.
Thank you. I love the answer about the president. Thank you. That's what I wanted to hear. We have time for a couple more questions. Mr. Vincenti.
My experience is that Italian Americans have gotten ahead in this country by being a more American and less Italian. America, if America, is the country of assimilation. How does the Italian American create something in this country that is lasting and fundamental besides things like pizza and family? What else is done? Have we done anything?
Why don't you answer? Because I'm not sure I can answer that.
Well, I don't know. The last chapter of my book is called We're All Italian. And what I argue is that there is a real joy today in Italian culture and that Americans really want to emulate. And it's not just the food, fashion, design, but it's certain values of the, you know, community over individual, of time versus profit, of a kind of value structure that you see in Italy that is not in America, where that we are so much more obsessed with time, with profit, with all of these things. And so maybe I'm just, you know, idealizing or fantasizing, but I think it would be wonderful if Italian Americans could incorporate more of those kinds of values. You know, if you read early immigrants' diary entries, they would say things like Italian artisans would say how their work wasn't valued in America because Americans were just interested in not art but in efficiency. And you see the great creations and the great stone and grape sculpture that Italian Americans have left us. So I think these are kind of eternal values, and I think we should look back to our roots and kind of think about that that's another legacy that Italian Americans.
How are success, the two of them, are kind of a dichotomy with the things you're talking about, family and friendship. You can't achieve success, and it could be an art. I'm not talking about money success only. Success and power. How do you achieve that by living that kind of life with family and not being as concerned?
Well, for example, family. Let's just take family. Let's put it into a political realm. Mario Cuomo is a perfect example of that. Mario Cuomo took the negative aspects of family, that we were clannish, that, you know, family was somehow a weak thing when you're supposed to be individual. You know, that's the whole spirit of America. You're supposed to be independent. And he said, we're the family of New York. And he turned it around and he made it a strength. And he used that metaphor. He'd always talk about how his mother, Immaculata, gained strength through her village and the sharing of benefits and burdens. Mario Cuomo did a brilliant job with taking the notion of the Italian family and making it a virtue, not a vice. So I think that there are ways to do that. But I agree with you, the notion of power and strength is really the opposite of these kind of communal values. But I do think there are ways that you can think about that and you could present them in a very positive light.
Just as a quick example, I had lunch yesterday with Lydia Bastianich, the chef. She has an empire. Her family has an empire. And it's all through her family. I met with her daughter, I met with her son, and these are all very successful people. She might argue she's Yugoslavia. But I do think it's the bedrock. And just as an aside, it doesn't speak to your power, but it is about families. So many families that I've met in the course of the 5 years of making this film, even when they intermarry an Irish or a German or whatever, it's that Italian culture that seems to predominate no matter what. And it's like, as I always say, it's like a strong cheese. You know, it just makes its way through the Sunday dinner. All that stuff it does matter in a kind of fractured American landscape. So maybe it's the bedrock of power. I mean, you could look at Generoso Pope in the film. I mean, you know, America is the crucible, I guess, and it forces you up, hopefully.
I love the strong cheese.
I know you do.
You can have a fonduta, quattro formaggi, cinque formaggi, but if you have a strong cheese, in it, it's what gives flavor to all the rest. We have a question from Professor Teresa Fiore. Thank you.
I would like to take Martino Marazzi's very interesting notion about Italy outside of Italy, and Italians becoming more aware of the Italian-American history, but at the same time becoming more aware of what is happening in Italy, and flip it around and say, what has been your experience in talking to all these people when they address immigration in the United States now? That is to say, what is the legacy of being an immigrant after generation and dealing with immigration today? What are the reactions that you have registered? Because it seems like there's a richness in remembering, in memory, and keeping it active and alive, so that the Rosarno-Roseto effect in a way does not repeat.
It's a great question. My experience has been, I worked with a historian named David Blight, a Lincoln historian, who used to say to me every once in a while, I was like, part of remembering is forgetting. And I think there's a selective part of which goes on with immigrants. And that's why I talked about that earlier. And it's sad, because if you were to ever sit down and watch All 4 Hours, or when you read the book, you'll see this sort of interesting arc of Italians who had come here, many of them radicals, anarchists. We flirted with fascism, progressivism. I mean, we run the gamut to, you know, one of the reasons I put Scalia in the film was because it really has come full circle now to somebody who has completely, he is impenetrable in the way he's kind of rewritten his familiar history. You'd never know they were immigrants. You know, they came here and they were all geniuses, and refers to his father as a brilliant linguist, and he might have been, but he was also, you know, like teaching in high school, and like he's just recreated this whole sort of back history for himself, which saddens me, because it's sort of like, okay, we've arrived, and so we're going to forget. And I thought what was really interesting and moving to me recently was when Obama was talking, his immigration speech talked about, we were all strangers once, which was so resonated with me, I think is why this film is important, not just for Italians, but for all immigrant groups, is we were all strangers once in this country, and it's so vitally important, even as we've made it, and if we've made it politically or in business, not to forget that experience, because we keep repeating it. We're doing it to on our borders now, and it's happening in Italy. And actually, the film has played in Rye, played over November, every Saturday in Rye, each hour. In Italy, and a lot of the discussions in the have been around this immigration issue and how Italians are treating their own immigrants, and so it's interesting that it has sparked that conversation in Italy. So hopefully that addresses what you're getting at.
Thank you. I think that's all the time we have for tonight. I just want to remind you that the documentary is going to air on PBS on February 17th and 24th. The book is available in bookstores, but we have copy upstairs for you to buy. I would like also to remind you that for those of you who are here, I think will be interested in the screening of another documentary by Gianfranco and Sue Manorelli that are present here. And it's entitled Finding the Mother Lode, and it's about Italian immigration to California. So it's a case study. And they were both the authors of Bitter Bread. And so it's a very good thing for us to have a chance to have a preview of that here at Casa Italiana, December 15th, 6 p.m. So mark your calendar and take a look at your inbox for the announcement of the preview of the PBS documentary, The Italian American. And please join me in thanking again Martino Marazzi, John Maggio, and Maria Laurino.